Hello everyone! Welcome back to the Path of the Great One. My microphone, while I was recording this part, apparently was switched off. So we're doing post-commentary now in the research hall. So maybe it'll have a different flavor than usual. This would have been the second episode when I was in the research hall. So we've done a lot of it, and I'll be working my way up the stairs, I guess. I don't really know what I was thinking at the time, but I guess I've got enough leeway that I can just talk and not have to worry about it. I think I was just mostly lamenting about how difficult it was to get up the stairs. We needed to get... I was killed by patience, that's right. And I was heading back up there so that I could get inside the room with the mad patients. And hopefully not get ambushed from the back. That meant that I ended up wandering around a little stupidly. Because you see, I'm worried that things are going to attack me from behind. So I keep, like, looking to see if I can set them off early. I think eventually I just decide to go for it. I don't think I ever walked through that room at any point. Because I think there's, like, sedatives in there and that's about it. So it's not really worth fighting everything in that room over them. But I'm like, are they coming? Nope. I think they do eventually come, but the trigger is probably the guy who ambushes you at the other end. This guy. So yeah, nothing much happens. Trying to carefully kill these guys so that we can head further into the level. Not too interesting, unfortunately. I'm sure the me fighting at the time finds them very interesting there. But I kind of knew that we were going to win, so it's like, yep. Not so bad. Plenty of time to die later. Oh, a bit jittery. The research hall is one of the more interesting levels for the DLC in terms of like details that is put into it. Because, was it the Hunter's Nightmare early part is all about the spectacle of being in a place you've already been, but different. The fishing village is cool, but a lot of it is literally just derelict houses and water. It's fun to actually meet a whole bunch of talking NPCs, spouting out little bits of lore.
I know, but I won't do it with darkness, and what rises from its very...
It's quite a few creepy set-piece moments in this... Not set-piece moments, what would you call them? Just this room. This room has no enemies in it. It just has these guys that you can either kill or leave alone or just listen to what they have to say. I tend to kill them, though, because I think it's a mercy. It seems like they've suffered enough. And that's the key. Which I almost, well, you'll see what happens later. I don't know how much later it'll be when we get the key, but it'll be sometime later for sure. Boom. Ow, ow. I have tons of trouble with these guys during this playthrough. Because I can't seem to get the auger to parry them properly, and they have one of the strongest hyper armors in the game. It seems. When their animation starts. They look like they're interruptible, but they're not. They're super strong. And their attacks do mad damage. If you get caught in the middle of them anyway. I'm kind of getting hit around the edges here. So not so bad. There, I finally get the parry in, and I probably... It was just a bet over. Probably didn't need it that much. Some old blood. What do I decide to do next? Probably go further up. I'm thinking at this point I'm trying to head to the roof. There isn't much point in hanging around in the lower levels. Go on. You can do it. Oh, wait. I think I'm going to try. Oh, wait. This becomes quite the circus. I've had pretty good success making that hunter drop off and kill himself with gunshots. I think I end up trying it with thrown items, but I think maybe we do this part first. Including the scary head grabby guy, who thankfully does not grab my head. The enemies in this area hit really hard, but they're actually a lot easier to kill than the ones in the first part of the DLC. The hunters and various other enemies in the Hunter's Nightmare tend to give more trouble, with a few exceptions. Those two really tall guys with the what do you call those medical pole things that you hang the drips off? Don't know if they have a name. Might literally just be called drip stands or something stupid. But yeah, those guys, fuck them. They're terrible. They're the worst thing in this level by far. So what do we do here? Yeah, here it is. I start looking around for things to throw. I think I said all knives. Let's see if I'm right. No? I go executioner's glove, do I? No, that's surely not a good idea. The thing is, I do get him to fall off, but... in doing that, I do not get him to die. And later on, that will turn out to be important. Yeah, I don't even know why I do this. It's not really the way you're supposed to do it. It's just something that I like to do every time I end up in the spot, which is I jump over and get the brain fluid immediately. But that screws up my run through the level. And I never realize it when I do it. I realize it later. I'm like, oh no. The level ends up twisting back around in itself, and I can't use the elevator because it's in the wrong spot. It's just not good.
Lady Marie, will I ever curl up and become a man? What say you? Say so.
Just enjoying the dialogue. It's very strange that I somehow managed to not record the audio for this. I'd been having a really good run up until this point of not screwing up the recordings. But then apparently, nope, I can't get through a single series without some mess up somewhere. There's no elegant way to hide this one. I can't really edit around this entire section, so let's just enjoy me realizing the elevator is in the wrong spot. And with that, I have to jump down to here. So I look around to see if there's anywhere else I can jump to. The answer's no, sir. I start trying to take out this guy. This is an enormous waste of bullets. And that guy is not likely to fall off under his own power, unlike the other one. So yeah, I end up... Do I literally just spam bullets until he's dead? Looks like I do. Oh dear, how cowardly. I pay for it though. Bad karma catches up with me. That was close. Down the stairs. And who should find us but this guy. And I am totally not ready for it. Yeah, I start madly trying to refill my bullets. I went into a slight panic here. And the auger unfortunately gets blocked very easily by even the slightest physical obstruction. If it clips a piece of scenery, even if the full animation goes off, it's not useful. So I can't really fire it around this pillar. So yeah. I'm trying to do my best here. But I'm very scared of this guy because he has an overpowered gun, like many hunters. Fire the tentacle into a pillar. It's right next to him, but it doesn't matter. Ow. And he phases through it, and then he shoots me twice, and then he hits me, and then shoots me. And that's what happens when he starts shooting, it just deletes you. Super annoying. I was trying really hard not to have that happen.
Sorry. Oh, that don't be greedy. I should.
And so, with that done, we start heading back up the stairs, it looks like. Flailing uselessly all the way. I'm just trying to remember if I go a different way this time, or if I'm wasting time here. I think I had a plan, it's just, I don't remember what it was. I think I ended up running past a bunch of people, because I was like, no, want to get back to where I was. Don't have time for this. Keep trying the tonsillitis, even though it's not working that well. Very important later. I'm doing this post audio. I've done a fair amount past this part, so I can give you little hints about the future if you wanted to, but I'll try not to. I was thinking I didn't want to fight this guy again. Actually, I think I'm gonna die. Hold on to your hats. There's a reason I remember these guys being the worst thing about this level. It'll be because they gave me an awful lot of trouble this particular playthrough. Oh wait, maybe I didn't die. It's just, there was definitely an edit there. I think that's because the PlayStation's 15 minutes were up and I had to very quickly restart the video. I saw the edit coming and I was like, did I hear? But yeah. It was something else. I also don't like when I visceral them and I just can't get in position. Because the visceral animations were definitely made with the gun in mind. The Augur of Edibris in the launch version of the game couldn't actually cause parries. So the timing is awkward by necessity, I would imagine. You weren't originally supposed to be able to do it, so just sort of fitting it in, it doesn't feel very elegant sometimes. And what was my plan here? My plan was just to get them to all come down as far as possible and have that wheelchair guy shoot them to death. And then run! Run! Because why not? I think I was like, yeah, better get the elevator. Because then I can't be sent back to the bottom anymore. And I won't have to go up those stairs. That was probably exactly what I was thinking. That secret entrance is useless though, because I already jumped out that way. These are really tough wheelchair guys. In a sense. Does it take 5 or 6 hits with the torch to kill one? That's some pretty abysmal damage I'm doing. That's pretty much how I felt about a lot of the enemies. Not so much in the fishing village though, but a lot of the... probably the ones in the fishing village were weak to fire. But a lot of the other enemies in the DLC are not weak to fire, and that's why they feel very sandbaggy. You hit them, but you don't really feel like you hurt them very much. I think some karmatic justice is coming up there. Let's see what happens this time. Yep, there it is. Whee! And that's the end of that chapter. And we rejoin our intrepid hero back where we lost the last time. Very uneventful trip up the stairs. Or up the elevators, I should say. Still no good at fighting this guy, though. I think I decided I don't want to fall down anymore, so I start taking the high ground against the rails. Then I go for the visceral attack to throw him off, and... nope. And then because of my elevation, the visceral attack animation doesn't go off again, and I almost get killed. That's one of the more annoying things about the visceral... it happened again, because I just didn't quite... Basically, I'm close enough to attack him, but I'm not technically close enough to cause the animation to trigger. It's actually one of the things I don't like about the visceral attacks in this game, is that the positioning is a lot more finicky than it seems at first. Particularly when you have to dash in to do it. A lot of the time I've dashed in and fallen just short, but it's not easy to tell. So you do a regular attack. And with a weapon, that wouldn't make much difference, but with a fist, it's the difference between doing hundreds of points of damage and 4. So it's really annoying. The absolute worst one, though, is when you're too far away and you have to dash in. But the dash phases you through their hitbox while they're on the ground, and you end up behind them. That will get you killed in some situations. Particularly against bosses like the Orphan of Koz, phasing through them is terrible. But there isn't much you can do about it, it's just the fact of life if you're going to visceral attack things. Every now and then you're going to mess it up real bad. That rat decides that he didn't want to live anymore. And I supported his decision. I think I just... like, there's not really a lot to do here. So I think I end up just saying, screw it, let's raise the thing. Turn the staircase. Ooh, sorry. It's a bit late at night to be doing this, but... no time like the present. This is a very cool part of the level. Yeah, the staircase has like a dual function. It's really cool that they built a staircase that is like able to like make sense in both locations. I think that's very very good level design. Like a lot of people would not go to the effort to do that. Certainly not quite as intricate as this. I'm certain if I looked at like a diagram of the whole thing, it would be a pretty simple little puzzle, but having built it into such a hugely detailed level is a nice touch. And we have to go kill the crow because it's got something valuable on him. And then I think we kill these crows? Yes, that makes sense. They're right in front of us. There's something shiny behind them. I would surely want it. This guy is probably my favorite NPC in this area.
And you too will hear.
Though I think I put him out of his misery this time.
Sound of what?
I love the foreshadowing. And the very Cthulhu-esque vibe it gives off. That's a very Lovecraftian thing. To have horrible things be beneath the water. And because of the enormous amount of water in the ocean, the little bits of insanity that come through it are all muffled so that humanity doesn't go mad. It's a pretty nice idea. There's a box here. And more crows. I like crows. Particularly don't like having to take 3 hits to kill them, but... useless blood gems that I don't need. It's unfortunate, but it's true. I didn't use a blood gem for anything during this entire playthrough. As far as I know, so far. Scary, naked running guys. Although, not so scary when you run all the way off the platform, huh? That was fancy of me. I was literally watching this wondering what I was going to do to deal with them because it looked like I was running away from them. Flamethrower wasn't a bad idea. Where do I go from here? Downstairs. Ah, the headless guys. Always fun. Random punch. I seem to have a memory of something going wrong here, but I don't know what it was. One of the few enemies in the game I can actually backstep with fair ease. Because they can't see. Maybe nothing went wrong. It's hard to imagine anything going wrong now. I'm pretty certain I never ran afoul of the bad guys. Bag. Not bad. Bag. Don't push any pressure plates. Blue elixir. Which surprisingly I never had to use. I think it would be useful in certain situations in a challenge version of this game, but never really came up, as far as I remember. I remember being pretty paranoid about the one above the doorway, but turns out to be a non-event. Nope, very peaceful. I'll tell you one thing though. This got a lot easier when I finally did get the black sky eye. I think I was trying to rush it around at this point. I was like, I'm gonna get the brain fluid. Gotta get downstairs and give it to what's her face. Oh. Yeah, I screwed up because I forgot this hunter was a thing. I'm trying to remember, did I cheapo him or did I flee? Because there's really no reward for beating him. Once you've actually got the brain fluid. So I think I just ran. Ow. A gun. I got stuck in a corner like a fool. Yep, there we are. I died. But I didn't run, so good on me.
A pretty sight, is it? The true face of the blood-worshipping, beast-purging, healing. But that's not all. You seek the secret, then here's what you must climb the Asjiha.
Now this is probably just me wandering around, grabbing all the items that I couldn't get before I lowered the staircase. And probably fighting a whole bunch of these straitjacket dudes rather futilely. What I should really... Oh wait, there was a bunch of abhorred beasts with their blood chunks that I wanted to. Couldn't let them go at this point, I needed them. My weapons were not very good, so I needed to upgrade them as much as I possibly could. I think I got really paranoid that a whole bunch of guys were going to come in, so I ended up standing at the door flamethrowering them. I'm pretty certain they can't come in though. I was probably wasting my time. I remember I had a few incidents like that where the flamethrower was actually blocking my own view. I couldn't actually see the thing that I was hitting. And the flamethrower itself doesn't really have any stagger animations.
Oh,
I'm still a little confused as to what sets her off. Because obviously I tried to give her the next brain fluid, but obviously she hadn't swapped her dialogue over yet. And it's usually a case of, do you have to use the blood? Do you have to take the blood and use it? And then reload the area? It's just... it gets annoying. I've never actually bothered to look it up, and I never quite figured it out either myself, what would actually cause her to advance her quest line, so to speak. But I think when I load it in, it switches over, so probably had something to do with the blood. About that. I've got a bit of a cough. Mostly from talking for half an hour. I'm probably talking more here than I would during an actual playthrough. This is a pretty long one, unfortunately. But I do most of the research hall, I think. Or rather, I've actually done most of the research hall. There's only a few little bits and pieces to collect. Aside from getting the Black Sky Eye, I think the only other thing of note around here is the lock shield, which was technically something I could have used during this playthrough without breaking my own rules, but it never really came up as a thing to do. It's not an especially useful item in this game. I suppose you could use it against someone like Ligarius, maybe, but, like, really? I learned to dodge all these attacks ages ago. I don't need a shield to tell me how to do that. Yeah, I realize I'm at the boss room and figure I've gone the wrong way. Because I'm trying to figure out which staircase actually takes me down to the lock shield. And then eventually I realize it's actually the staircase that takes you all the way up. But I think I take an unauthorized shortcut down. Thinking about it, there we go. It's a shame that the visceral attacks really can't operate properly when you're on a staircase. I've had so many occasions where the visceral attack has missed. Because I've been standing slightly above the target. Lock shield. Good. And now I'm probably talking about the lock shield right now in the video. Saying all the things that I just said before. Fist of Gradio was kind of disappointing. Because at first I thought I didn't have the strength to use it, and then I realized I did. And so I was like, oh, I can use this. And then it was like, nope. The damage it does isn't even comparable to the Hunter's Torch at all. Like, it's strictly bad damage. Probably does damage around the same amount as the regular torch. Which is saying something. Because I have a lot of arcane, and even then, the regular torch does almost nothing. Given that I put all my stats into arcane, it's no wonder the Hunter's Torch actually does quite a bit of damage. But, then again, quite a bit is all very relative, isn't it? 100 and something damage per hit is not a lot, in the grand scheme of things. Even with all my arcane. I had a fun idea for a new game plus build, where you use the Cos Parasite and the Fist of Gradia in combination and become a boxer in Bloodbourne. Because why not? Oh, that's right, I need the actual key to the cells. It's in here. Something goes very wrong here when I try and do this. But I won't tell you what the outcome is. Look at that. That was... I knew it was coming. I tried to do something about it, and I still messed it up. And I start panic Oedipusing at the wall. But at least we got the key. What was my next move here? Because I'm pretty certain everything's done now. And I think I realize it too. Eventually. And randomly two-hand my weapon. That got me killed once too. accidentally two-handing while I had no weapon equipped. Am I really just gonna wander around here? Nope, I finally realize there's nothing to do. I figure it may as well reload the area. I'd probably then go visit Adeline or whatever her name is. Because I really wanted that balcony key. So immediately rush, turn right, run past this guy. And I realize Adeline is agitated, and I'm like, yes! Excellent! Though I still waste time going up with the person when I don't need to. As far as I know, they just don't follow you in. There's no reason to actually fight them. And I run out of bullets. Because this is Bloodbourne and not Dark Souls 3. And using Hello? Your Homeward Bone equivalent doesn't restock Hello? Your supplies.
Is anyone there? Please, somebody, I need to help. I'm trying.
Yes, this was a very exciting part of the playthrough, which I'm unfortunately don't have audio for.
Please, I need brain fluid. Please bring me. I must have it. Without it, I'll be sent back. Yes, that's it.
Yum.
Ah, thank you. Take this charm. Lady, please, do not abandon. Oh, the sticky sound. The drip. How extraordinary. Do you think that water drips even down deep below at the bottom of the sea?
Oh dear.
Can you hear it? Drip. Drop. Drip.
And after examining all the dialogue, I was very excited about this. The Black Sky Eye is for PvE, like an arcane PvE build, the Black Sky Eye is an invaluable tool. Largely replaces the Executioner's Gloves for pretty much all occasions. Because the Executioner's Gloves are pretty slow, and having to spend 3 bullets instead of 1 is a bit of an odd... It leads to odd math, let's say. When you're trying to restock your bullets. Particularly if you're using blood bullets, like, it's just... It's like, okay, I got 5 bullets, I have to use 3, and then now what? Can't use the Executioner's Glove anymore. Pretty certain I don't spend any time here doing anything other than just running and grabbing it. This is the most reliable way I figured out to do this. Just fighting them is annoying. It just ends up being too many lasers. I didn't want to play cover-based shooter with them. So I just went and grabbed it. And went about my business. And that should be the end of the video. So, yeah. We'll probably get a little clip of me doing a little goodbye, and then we'll be done. So, thanks for watching, everybody. Sorry we had to do this in post-audio, but we will see you in the next episode, where hopefully the audio will be completely fine. I'll actually have to go see about that right now. Bye for now.